Andy, before we begin our PowerPoint program, if you would find a video on there called Let My People Go. It's just a clip, not all of the song, but it's an iconic song about the Exodus story. It's sung most memorably, I think, by Louis Armstrong with the animation there. Bring up the sound of the lights down, if you would. Sound up just a little bit, Andy, if you can, get a little more juice out of it.
Let my people go. Oppressed so hard they could not stand. Let my people go. So the Lord said, go down.
I just had the web address, it's walnutgrovebaptistchurch.net, on our sign out here. And I attribute perhaps this increase in traffic. But this is important because on our website, if you've never been there before, I encourage you to go there. You may not use a computer or the internet at all, but there are sermons by so many different people, songs. There are lessons. There are links to videos. Our church calendar is there. The plan of salvation is explained, and there's a tab for that. There's a connection to all the information about our church cemetery here. Everything that we could put up there that we feel would be helpful or encouraging. And so there were 410 people last week. Maybe you, me, I know I didn't go there 400 times. I probably went there once or twice. But 410 people visited our website last week and had access to all of that. It's not just an advertisement, and it's not just a placard or a billboard sign. There's lots of information there and lots of inspiration there. Just about anybody who's ever preached or sang at our church, we even had Larry Whitman's testimony there in the last 7 or 8 years can be accessed there from Bo Shedd, Mr. Brown, Sue Brown, what's called? Yeah, blew it out of your mind. Yeah.
Linda
Sue Brown. My goodness, Linda Sue Brown. And every time that Jason's been here with us in the last few years, so all of those things are there. And you can see that there are 218 people who visited who had never been there before. And they're unique visitors. Go on to the next slide there, Andy. Here's something else. If you do not have a daily time that you say, this is my time with God, You really need one. Every Christian needs to have, we used to call it a devotional time, a quiet time. But every Christian, you need to read the scriptures, even if just a verse. Have prayer. Or let your mind turn to where you're listening to God. It doesn't have to be hours. It can be just a few minutes. But every Christian needs a devotional time. Listen, one of the first things you need to be able to start doing as a new Christian is learning to feed yourself. Do you know that shepherds don't feed sheep? Here. No, he just says, there it is, eat it. And you know, they feed themselves. Now I have seen a shepherd, he had a lamb in his arms and he had a bottle, and that's something in unique circumstances to see a shepherd actually feeding one of his sheep. But the shepherd would just lead them to where the grass is, and they had to learn how to chew it and how to swallow it. So all babies need to learn how to feed themselves. Learn how to find what nourishes you and what can make you strong. Don't be dependent upon what you get at church or what you get from the preacher or the teacher. They're all good. They're great. Danny and I, how many sermons did we hear this weekend? Probably five or six? Boy, and he was thinking this morning that he probably didn't even need to come to church this morning to hear one more sermon. I said, no, you got to come today. It's Father's Day. Don't be dependent on other people spoon-feeding you. That's one thing I've learned lately about being sick. Is there people bringing you food and put food in your mouth or giving you something? And I finally got to that place where I can find my own food now. So that means it's an indication not only that I've grown up, but I'm getting well. All right? But we have our daily bread. And it's a little booklet that has it's like a TV dinner. it's a little page, just one page, and it's got your scripture, your prayer, and a thought, and it's always excellent. It's always so good. It's just a biteful, and it may be just what you, if you don't have a daily devotion, you can pick one of those up on your way out. There are some at this entrance down here, and it's something, a ministry that our church supports, to make sure that you can have a copy of this. This is for June, July, August of this year. This is the current edition. And you can just take that, put it in your Bible, put it on your bedside, put it in the glove compartment of your car. And if you don't have that or something like that, let me encourage you to have a daily time. And something like this, if you just kind of wander around and say, well, I don't know what I want to eat. I don't know what I want to hear or see or read. This is scheduled for you, and there's one for every day. And I remember we used to have to kind of put Daddy's medications. We got in one of those little dividers. I've got one, too. When you get old, you get a pill divider for every day. Daddy called my brother one day, and he says, I think I got my AM and my FM medicine mixed up. And sure enough, he did. He had his AM and his FM medicine completely messed up. So I've got my AM and my PM medicine too, and I got Monday through Friday. And our daily bread is a good thing like that. And it's just a little pocket. Keep it in your pocket. Keep it in your purse. And get one of those. We give them away here too. Every time people come by here that might not pick up the Bible and read it, if they can read the Bible because it's a verse of Scripture, in every daily dose of our daily bread. When Jesus was tempted by the tempter to turn a stone into bread, he says, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. And that's the kind of bread that's offered in this little booklet. Get you one. And if you don't have one, you can do, what's the Upper Room? That's another very popular one. Now this also is available on our website. So if you don't want to get the booklet, you can go to our church website and go to the links, and there's a link on there. And today's edition of our daily bread is right there. It can be on your smartphone. It can be on your tablet or your pad or your laptop or your computer. All right. Let's go ahead. Let's start the message. Let my people go. Go down, Moses. Tell old Pharaoh, let my people go. Let's go on to the next slide. Getting out of Dodge, and this is installation number 17. And you know, this is not all about just the book of Exodus, though. I think sometimes when preachers or pastors come and they'll stay about 2 years, they start with their basic sermons. But if you change pastors or preachers every 18 months or every 2 years, then all you ever get are just basic sermons. So we might be in that realm of my service here with you as your pastor, where I'm preaching the kind of sermons maybe that you've never heard before. And you may, it may make you feel a little uncomfortable that things that you don't know about or haven't heard about, or that you've never heard anybody preach about. Well, that's what happens when you don't get rid of your preacher after a few years. He starts preaching the whole Bible, and you find out that everything in the Bible is good, whether we like it or not. As a matter of fact, the more I read about the Bible, and the more I read in the Bible, the more I don't like about it, because it tells me about me, and it makes me repent, and shows me my sin and my weaknesses. Let's go on. Now, I mentioned last Sunday, and I'm not picking on the Egyptians, and I'm really not trying to elevate the Israelites. But in this story, God is determined for everybody reading this to see the difference between Israelites and Egyptians. People who believe in God and people who don't. Whatever you do and wherever you go and however you live your life, God wants the things in your life, the circumstances. God wants everything about your life to demonstrate the difference that He has made in your life. People ought to be able to look. If I were a lost person, I ought to be able to be around a Christian person and see that he's not just irritating and that he's annoying, or that he's always talking about Jesus, but that there are some things about him to admire that are inspiring, that are noteworthy, that catch your attention. Israelites and Egyptians, I believe the goodness and grace of it doesn't matter. It might be raining in your life. It might be stormy. You might be going through tremendous trials. You know, Jesus said it this way. He causes it to rain on the just and the unjust. And yet still God says, when it's raining on the just and the unjust, you ought to be able to see a difference. God's people, we ought to be different. We respond differently. We behave differently. We see things differently. We're children of God. And so in this story, I mentioned last Sunday, if you wake up and there are frogs in your bed, and there's lice in your hair, and there's flies in your cornflakes, you're an Egyptian. Now, all of that was going on in Egypt. And it was for everybody there, it was a terrible place to be. It was a terrible time in which to be living. And yet, God was saying, just look around. And God was showing His favor upon His people. And the goodness and the graciousness of God was being demonstrated. And so, this is what God wants to do in my life and in your life. Is that this person has cancer and he doesn't know God. And I have cancer. What's the difference? Can you look at us and say, does it make any difference? Does it mean anything? There is a great difference. And God says, let's show them the difference. Let's go on, Andy. Here in Exodus chapter 4, verse 21 and 20 through 23. And the Lord said to Moses, when you return to Egypt, do all those wonders before Pharaoh, which I have given you the ability to perform. But I will harden his heart so that he will not let the people go. Now hold right there for just a minute, Andy, because this is something very important. God is never going to come to you and say, do this and say that. Let's see what happens. Let's see what happens. Let's see how that works. What happens? Let's let it go. No, he says, go do this and go say this to Pharaoh. And then God says, this is what's going to happen. You know, when the Bible says that God knows the future, it's not because he read his horoscope today or he went to the Chinese restaurant and got a fortune cookie. The reason God knows the future is because God makes the future. What God wants, the will of God, happens. You heard that other thing, and maybe seen it on a bumper sticker, that this happens? Well, listen, let me tell you something that's even more powerful, if that's powerful. The will of God happens. The will of God happens. Here, go do this. Go say that. He says, I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart. In other words, he says, I'm going to put something in motion. I'm going to make something happen so that the specific thing that I want to have happen is going to happen. He says, I'm locking the conclusion into place. You see, I believe in destiny. I believe in meaning. And that things have value and that there is purpose. I believe Lane picking out Shannon's name. Yeah, you know what a Hindu person would call that, don't you?
Karma.
Karma, yeah. Karma. I don't believe in karma. I believe that God's doing things to make things happen. My dad used to just believe that things just happened, and it was just like eeny, meeny, miny, moe. Daddy believed in whack-a-mole theology. Talked a little bit about that last Sunday night. That just things would pop up their head and God would whack it. That's not true. He says, Moses, go tell Pharaoh, and he says, this is what's going to happen when you tell him. Let's go on, let me show you something. He says, and say to Pharaoh, this is what the Lord says. Israel is my son. My firstborn son. And this is what I have to say to you. Let my son go that he may serve me. And when you refuse to let him go, watch. I will slay your son, even your firstborn. Leave it right there, Andy. I want that to sit. Let's let that soak into our brain pan. Long before, maybe not long, let me just say it this way. Before there was a let my people go message, there was a let my son go. Now, ladies, we understand that what he's talking about there, that he's just speaking generically, and what he means is it's more than people, but he's saying, let my children go. He said, Israel, he said, look, go tell Pharaoh this. Israel is my son, my firstborn. Now, the firstborn son, Danny and I went to a men's conference. So we walk up to the door. We're going to pay when we get there. I'm digging my money out. And so this nice lady who's helping us looks at him, looks at me. She could have picked either one of us. And she said, I've got a free ticket here for you. I'm saying, hey, free ticket. I'm digging my money out. I said, okay. I said, well, my mother always loved him best anyway. But I'm the firstborn. That means there's more pictures of me. And I got a baby book. And they have a little piece of my hair. He ain't got none of that stuff. He was just the other one. When I was a pastor at Old Park Baptist Church, one of our members, a husband and wife, asked us to meet in my study one Wednesday night before church. And they had some news to tell us. We already thought we knew. They were expecting. And then they said, we just came from Birmingham, we want to tell you. Said, I think we already know. We're having three babies. We're having three babies. And they were having triplets. We sat down. They're all grown up now. Big old grown up kids. They had a first cousin that was also, that her family attended our church. There were two little boys and a little girl. And their cousin had not yet learned to distinguish them from each other. And so she just talked about them and the girl. Those two and the girl. Well, I'm the firstborn. And it doesn't have as much significance now, but in that day, the firstborn was to be in training from the time that he was born to take over the father's position sometime in his life. And when it came time for the inheritance to be passed along, you know, these days we kind of try to divide everything up. Well, guess what? In ancient times, the firstborn always inherited everything. And he took care of everybody. That was what he was supposed to do. That was the idea. It worked a lot of the time. The reason I put this together is I wanted you to see that, yeah, later on when he gets to Pharaoh, he's going to say, "Let my people go." But God says, "Tell Pharaoh, Israel is my child." They're slaves. They're your slaves. They're your workers. They're just like cattle to you. He says, "Let me tell you something. They're my children. They're my children." You need to know that. You need to know that. Sometimes I think that. I try not to say it out loud because it kind of sounds like a threat. Somebody would say something ugly or accusatory. Someone trying to whittle me down or make me feel bad. I hear my own voice back in my mind saying, "Do you know who I am? I'm a child of the King. I'm a child of God. Child of God." Let's go on. I showed you this last Sunday because these are the icons that indicate the 10 plagues that God was to bring upon Egypt, starting with turning the Nile River and all the water around Egypt into blood, and then frogs, lice, flies, cattle, so on. This one indicates the death of the firstborn. All firstborn children in Egypt would die. These are the 10 plagues. Go tell Pharaoh, and then I'm going to bring these plagues. But he says, "I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to harden Pharaoh's heart." Now, show this next slide there. In the passage that we just read, God didn't mention all of these plagues. He only mentioned one. He says, "Israel is my son." And he says, "If you don't let my son go, my firstborn, I'm going to slay your firstborn." That's the 10th plague. Now, it's important for you not to see, or to see that this is not the case, that God says, "Well, let's try turning the Nile to blood and see what that does." Well, that didn't work. Let's bring frogs. Frogs everywhere. Let's see if that will change Pharaoh's mind. No, that didn't work. That failed. That didn't do the trick. Let's bring lice so that everything, all their skin and their hair is crawling. No, that's not what's happening. God had already made up his mind that he was going to do this whole show and that this is what he was heading for all along. And he'd already told Moses, he's not going to change his mind because I'm not going to let it. You see, God wasn't trying this to see if it worked and then trying that to see if it worked. That's the way you and I do things. These are not indicative of 9 failures and finally God figured it out. No, because when he told Moses, "Go tell Pharaoh, let my firstborn go or I'm going to slay your firstborn." He says, "I want to tell you right now, we're going to go through a long show, a lot of song and dance." God says, "Let me tell you where I'm headed." Let's look at the next slide. You see, God had already 430 years before, or 450 or 480 years before, chosen a man named Abraham. And he says, "Abraham, I'm going to give you all of this land." Mark that in red here. is the promised land. He detailed and described very specifically the geographical location of the promised land. He told Abraham, this is going to be yours. He's already told Moses and the children of Israel, I'm taking you out of Egypt to the promised land. You see, God has a plan. It's a long-range plan that doesn't just involve 480 years. It involves eternity. There was already a promise. There was already something God was going to do and that was involved in doing that was going to use Abraham and his people to be a nation of people who would be a blessing to all the nations of the world. That through them, the salvation of God would come. That's what God's doing. He's not whittling this out of a stick as he goes. Let's go on. Remember on Mother's Day we talked about how God reached down and the Egyptians were killing all newborn sons. And God used a mother and a sister and a stepmother to save Moses' life because he was part of the plan. God was doing something. God had a plan. Remember when God, there's going to come a time when God's going to come to you too and say, hey, I got your whole life planned. I've got eternity planned for you. Let me let you in on just a little bit of it. Moses said, oh no, I don't want to go. Get somebody else. I'm not interested. I can't speak. And even though we have a whole chapter there in the book of Exodus of Moses saying no to God, God says, oh, look, I saved your life when you were a baby. I brought you here to this burning bush. I have a plan for you. Do you think God doesn't know about your life and about tomorrow? And he doesn't know about tomorrow because he's people. It's because he's ordained. There's a purpose for your life. Not just important people like Moses. Do you know that you're just as important to God as Moses is or was? Let's go on, man. No, Moses. It doesn't matter how qualified you think you are, or what you'd rather be doing, or what you had in your own dreams and plans were, you're going to wind up in a Cecil B. DeMille movie, parting the Red Sea. That's what's going to happen. God says, no, this is going to happen. I'm making this happen. Let's go on. Now that's an old painting. Does anybody recognize what it's depicting?
Our code.
Yeah?
They got it on their shoulders carrying it.
All right. What's the scene? Anybody? I think our children studied it recently on Wednesday night.
David bringing it back to Jerusalem.
No, this right here is Joshua.
Joshua.
Jericho. There's the water. So they, when they went out there and they, when they put their feet in it, that's the Jordan River. No, Moses, we're going to the promised land. And then when they walked out into the Jordan River right there, the Jordan River parted just like the Red Sea had. And they walked across on dry land. God has a plan for your life. You know, fathers have plans for their children. We hardly ever father. You know, there was a time when if your father was a carpenter, you'd be a carpenter. If he was a plumber, you'd be a plumber. Kind of follow in your father's footsteps. And that still happens. Still happens sometimes. But God is the kind of father, he says, I have a plan for you. And your life is happening. And I'm not figuring it out as I go. Let's go on to the next slide. Let my son go. Go on to the next slide, Amy. Let my children go. Next. In John 1:12, it says, to everyone who received him, who received Jesus, God gave them power to become his children, everyone who believed in his name. You see, when you become a child of God, it's because he gave you the power. He gave you the ability, the desire. It was his choice of us. He brought us in, and we're his children. He's our father. And he not only has warm, fuzzy feelings about what he'd like for us to be or become, he's the sovereign Lord of the universe, and he's bringing it to pass. He's making it happen. He knows everything about your life for the rest of your life in eternity. He's seen the beginning of your life, and he's seen you in eternity. Time doesn't exist for God. God knows everything about your life. And sometimes when you think you know more about your life than God does, or you know better than God, God says, no, he doesn't. You see, the matter is spending my life submitting to the will of God, saying yes to God, not wondering what's going to happen next. God says, I know exactly what's going to happen next, and I'm leading you towards it. He's a good father. Close this out, Andy, and I want you to bring down the house lights. There's a youth group who has done a drama that portrays their interpretation of a song entitled, It's Who You Are, or A Good, Good Father. I want you to play that for us, Andy, and I want you to watch this very carefully about what these young people want to say to me and you about this song and about our Father.
It's who I am. It's who I am.
pray with me? Let's bow our heads for just a moment. Every head bowed and every eye closed. You see your Father. You have to let Him bring you in. You have to let Him adopt you. You have to let Him make you a member of His family. Right now with heads bowed and eyes closed, if you've never given your life to Christ, would you do that right now? There are so many in this life who will betray you, who will mistreat you. There are some who will love you, perhaps even many. There's no one who will love you like your Heavenly Father. Give Him your whole life. Give Him who you are and who you always were and will become. So that when someone says, "Who are you?" you can say, "I'm loved by a good, good Father. That's who I am. That's who I am." Father, as we pray today, as hearts are open, I don't know what needs are today or what might be needed in any heart today or in every heart. But I pray that you would touch some empty heart, if there's one here today, or if there's someone who doesn't feel loved or cared for, or someone who's felt rejected, or feel that they've been betrayed or wounded. Let them know how deeply and strongly and eternally you love them. It's who you are. You're a good, good Father. We're your children. For that we thank you. We know that only in eternity will we begin, even just begin to see all that that means. For Lord Jesus, we pray it in your name. Amen.